Good evening. Ooh, sorry.
That was awesome.
Said that and 100 people just went, Oh, welcome. My name is Joe McCarthy. I'm the band director here at the high school, and I'm very happy to present to you our Nashoba Symphonic Band. This group is a culmination of a number of countless hours of work throughout this year, as well as last May when we started this group. It consists of both Nashoba students, students from surrounding towns, Nashoba faculty, parents, members of our community, members of surrounding communities, and anyone that just wants to come together to be able to perform some great symphonic music. So this is the ensemble. We're about 85 members strong, and we're always looking for some more folks to join us in the fall. So if you're interested, you played a number of years ago and you still have it in your closet or something, just shoot me an email. There's some information out on the desk there at how to join us. We'd love to have you. Tonight, we would like to present our final concert of the year, and this is also, if you could tell by the theme, our graduation concert. So it's a one-act, about an hour and 15-minute long performance, and we're going to also recognize the seniors of the group, both from Nashoba and from some surrounding high schools. So without further ado, I would like to present to you the Nashoba Symphonic Band.
Thank you.
Well, give him a microphone and we're all in trouble. I have to tell you that I graduated from high school 50 years ago this past Saturday. So this is a graduation concert, all right. No, I don't know if that's good. And the summer after I graduated from high school, I took a job selling Mr. Softy ice cream. And 50 years later, here I am, and the truck is backed up at the back, and I have fudgesicles, and I have ice cream sandwiches, and some popsicles. But I did. That was my first job between high school and college was, right, well, but not, you can't get away, you know. The first piece that we played, interestingly enough, it's called Totem Pole, but it has no Indian or Native American connotations at all. It was sort of a device that they were using at the beginning in the 1950s, which was building cords in blocks, so that it was building the cords up like a totem pole, so you'd have a head here and a layer and then another layer. And if you'll think back to how this sounded, we're not going to play it again, but the whole thing was just layers of instruments coming in. As the scale would go down, the other layers would come up. So it's very interesting. One of the things we're trying to do with this band is play music that's appropriate, that was written originally for for a concert band, not wind ensemble, which is a little more esoteric, but for concert symphonic band, which is an American style of playing. But we're starting with our four runners, which was the British bands. And so each year we'll be doing a certain amount of British band music. We did some in the last concert. And we're about to now play a couple of pieces on the program by a gentleman by the name of Rafe Vaughan Williams, who you may have heard of in other connotations. And you'll recognize a lot of his music in John Williams' music, because John Williams used a lot of British composers as his sort of prototype. And it was a very big thing at that particular time, in the 1920s, and actually a little earlier than that, to be very interested in the folk songs of a region or an area that you were from. And this is something that was growing then. Grieg had been doing it. A gentleman by the name of Percy Granger had been doing it. A gentleman by the name of Bela Bartok had been going around Hungary and that part of the world collecting folk songs. And so it was a big thing to do. And Von Holst, who we've played some pieces by, and Vaughan Williams as well, were collecting the folk songs of different areas of Great Britain and putting them into suites. And these are pieces that they're based on folk songs, but these are original band music. These aren't arrangements or anything by other people. These are people that by Holst and Rafe Vaughan Williams and real composers that did major, major works that were now writing for a new band medium and writing for a new sound. And they weren't just marching bands anymore. They were this wonderful combination of woodwinds and brasses and percussion. So it was a brand new sound. So we're going to go now to his folk song suite, which is it's five or six different folk songs. And it was written in 1923. By Rafe Vaughan Williams, and we think you'll enjoy. This is the English Folk Song Suite. We are pleased to have Evan Daisy play this piece for us. Again, we're in keeping with one of our goals. This piece, Rimsky-Korsakov, who I'm sure you've all heard of, that wrote Scheherazade, you know, Russian Easter, and all kinds of things, he actually wrote this for trombone and concert band. So he's one of the first classic composers that actually composed. He also wrote a clarinet concerto for clarinet and band. So we're very happy tonight to have Evan playing the Rimsky-Korsakov trombone concerto.
I just wanted to thank everybody in the audience and behind me on stage who has helped me do all of the things I do musically. And I wanted to dedicate this to my grandfather.
Thank you.
All right, it is my pleasure, and sort of, I'm gonna drop things. My pleasure to congratulate and recognize the seniors within our band. These guys have been here throughout the entire year, and this is our inaugural season of the Nashoba Symphonic Band. So we wanted to take a second to recognize not only just the Nashoba seniors, but then all of the seniors that we have in the group from the surrounding high schools. So, in no particular order other than the one that's on this stand, Nick Nastassi, clarinet player. Also in our clarinet section, Noah Bradley. Noah's a senior at St. John's. Back in our percussion section, Sarah Chase. In our tenor sax section, who couldn't be here at this concert, Catherine Abrams. And of course, the gentleman that we just heard play that phenomenal piece, Mr. Evan Daisy, trombone.
Well, I think we can give them all a hand.
And one thing I will add is that this is the beginning of our life as a concert band, but it's also the beginning of traditions. From now on, at our graduation concert, we will invite all of our graduates to come back and play a number with us at the end of each program. So, in another 10 years, there won't be room in the audience. We'll all be spilling out. But we're so pleased that this is working out and that we have so many students participating, and there's a lot more of them up here that are coming along. So thank you guys for being a part of this and that we can be a part of your lives. So congratulations. You may return here. Now you can go back. We're going to move on with another British band classic, which is a favorite of mine. It's called Toccata Marziale, and it's again by Ralph Vaughan Williams. And toccata means, it's from an Italian word, toccare, to mean to touch. And it has to do with touching across different notes quickly and delicately. It was a big hit. You'll hear of toccatas and fugues in Baroque music. Good Bach wrote a lot of them in books to Huda and other people. But Vaughan Williams chose to go to some of the older forms of music and sort of give him his British band touch to them. So this is the wonderful Toccata Marziale by Ralph Vaughan Williams. By the way, if you're in the Ralph Vaughan Williams Society on Facebook, they congratulated our concert today because they like it when you play his music.
Thank you.
Now we're going to move from the sublime to the ridiculous. This next piece is called Pachinko. Now a pachinko, does anybody know what one is? So I see some nods. Well, it's a slot machine, or it's a pinball machine is what it is. It's a Japanese pinball machine. And Paul Yoder, who wrote this particular this piece, back in the 1950s, he was very popular as a composer of school band and orchestra music, but he also wrote for colleges, and he became sort of our musical ambassador to Japan at a time when it wasn't very popular to be a musical ambassador to Japan in the mid-50s. But he went over and he learned how to write some of the things in Japanese musical style, and he took with him American musical styles, which they missed quite a lot on during the war years, as did the Europeans. I had the privilege of being a musical arranger for the Air Force bands in Germany in the post-war, World War II, and part of our job as a musical arranger, and Paul Yoder was the same thing. Part of his job was to bring music that had been, just wasn't there in the 30s, 40s, and early 50s. And so Paul Yoder he's very influential as an ambassador to learn these differences in styles between the two cultures and sort of combine them. And we think that you'll hear the influence, but it's a lot of fun. Pachinko, and it doesn't say exactly tilt, and we hope it doesn't, but have fun with it. This is Pachinko by Paul Yoder. So that's kind of fun. Our last major work on tonight's last major work tonight is Victory at Sea. And you got to be an old guy like me to remember Victory at Sea in its original form. But we think there's so much on TV now. But Victory at Sea was just this incredible piece, or this incredible first documentary that went on for several weeks back in the 50s. And it had to do with all of the naval battles during World War II. But it was the first long, you know, there were hour-long segments of Victory at Sea. And that was big for then, and it won an award for it, and the music won an award for it. And they asked Richard Rodgers, who, of course, wrote all those, you know, The King and I and Sound of Music, and Sound of Music hadn't been written yet, but a lot of those in Carousel, to write the music for all this. And he wrote the tunes all right, but the person who is really responsible for most of the work on this, just, I think it's 47 hours, 48 hours altogether of music, because it was constant music through the whole thing. There was narration, I think it was Walter Winchell, and it was a couple of others that did the narration, but it was 48 hours of constant music, and there was repetition of themes, like you'll hear in movies and things, but the person responsible for it was this gentleman by the name of Robert Russell Bennett. Now, Robert Russell Bennett was responsible for scoring almost all of the pit orchestra parts for the Rodgers and Hammerstein musicals, as well as things for George Gershwin and things for Cole Porter and things for Lerner and Lowe. And he was like the go-to guy to be a musical arranger. So when you hear a lot of this music, it's due to this wonderful gentleman, Robert Russell Bennett, who you'll be hearing more of in the coming concerts. So this goes through, you can hear the different sorts of themes and the different kinds of moods that it sets. So Victory at Sea by Richard Rodgers. I think Richard Rodgers was very indebted to that gentleman for all of his hard work. Victory at Sea. Thank you all very much. Our final piece this evening will be one that you'll recognize from a television show, but a British television show, I might add. And I will also add that about partway through, don't expect a foot to come down and squash you. Now, those of you who know what I'm talking about will understand. The rest of you are going, I don't know what he's talking about. And maybe you don't anyway. Anyway, the Liberty Bell, John Philip Sousa.
October 29th. Be here. Thank you. Good night. Have a great day.